chapter 1. I'm going to read you from verse 8, and then from chapter 2, verse 1 to 7. Revelation chapter 1, verse 7. Behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which cursed him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, saith the Lord, which is, and which was, and which is to come, the Almighty. I, John, who also am your brother, and companion in tribulation, and in the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle that is called Patmos, for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet, saying, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. And what thou seest, write in a book and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus, and unto Smyrna, and unto Pergamos, and unto Thyatira, and unto Sardis, and unto Philadelphia, and unto Laodicea. Reading from chapter 2, verse 1. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things said he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know thy works, and thy labor, and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars, and hast borne and hast patience, and for my name's sake hast labored and hast not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent unto the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. But this thou hast, that thou hastest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I hate, I also hate. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit said unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. May the Lord bless the reading of his word and grant us all understanding as we study it tonight. Bless him. Revelation chapter 2, verse 1. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things said he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I wouldn't dare to give any introduction or any background to the book of Revelation. And I think the best reference I can give you is to take you back to Thanksgiving Day Bible study. Pastor gave a wonderful introduction to the book of Revelation, and that says it all. So, just to put forth the fact that I'm going straight into the seven churches and starting tonight by the first one, the church of Ephesus. And it's interesting because the seven letters are letters sent by the Lord Jesus Christ. The risen Lord, the glorious Lord, the living Lord is sending and writing seven letters to seven different churches. They are individual churches which literally exist. So they are not mystical and they are not just symbolic, but they literally existed. And
We don't need to make something mystical or mysterious about the order in which they are given the seven churches, because if you have noticed in the reading, Ephesus, the first one, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. There is nothing mystical about that order, but actually the order is just following the postal route, because the church of Ephesus was the nearest church to Patmos, the island or the isle of Patmos, where John was banned and exiled because of the testimony of Jesus Christ. So it was the postman itinerary starting from the church of Ephesus, which was the nearest to the farthest one, which is the church of Laodicea. But the Lord is sending a specific and personal message to each church. So it is a specific but also personal message to each church. And it's interesting because John, the apostle, obeyed exactly to what he has been told to do. This is why we have the book of Revelation. But it's interesting, you will note that as we proceed in the study, starting from with Ephesus, but the name of each city and the name of each church gives us an idea about its spiritual condition. Ephesus means relaxed. And you will see how they were relaxed, and they took it too easy. And this is why the Lord said, I have something against thee. So it's important also to see that there is no need to say the church of Ephesus or the church of Pergamos or the church of Smyrna corresponds to a particular time in church history. We don't have such warrant in the scriptures, and the reason is because there are many other churches in that time which were not just the seven churches. There was the church of Corinth, there was the church of Philippi, there was the church of Thessalonica. So all those churches existed that time, but in a specific way, the Lord Jesus Christ is writing to the seven churches because from that time until the coming back of the Lord Jesus Christ, the whole gospel age, what we call the gospel age, in every church, in every epoch, in every era, you will find some aspect, a little bit of each aspect described to us, which you find in each of the seven churches. Why? Because in verse 7, Revelation 2, verse 7, the letter is addressed particularly to the church of Ephesus, but if you read verse 7, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit said unto the churches, not just one church, but to all the churches. So even though the Lord is speaking, the letter is particularly directed and addressed to the church of Ephesus. In extension, God is speaking to every church nowadays, until when the Lord Jesus Christ will come back again on this earth. So it is a very relevant message to every church in every age. It is prophetical, it is collective to many, to all the churches, it is practical, but it is also personal. So we come tonight to the first church, or the first letter, directly written by the Lord Jesus Christ from heaven to the church in Ephesus. But before we explain and we expose more about what is happening with the church, it's good to remind ourselves that the city of Ephesus was one of the biggest cities in the Roman Empire in the past. Actually, after Rome, you have the city of Ephesus. And it was inhabited by, people don't have an exact number, but it was between 250,000 to 500,000 people in Ephesus, just in the city, which believe me, from the past, that's a big megapole, it's a big church. It's a big city, which can be compared to our own city nowadays. So the city itself is very famous because it has been called the mother city of that region, and it has also been called the bank and the light of Asia. And Ephesus became very popular. Those things do not feed our souls. I understand very clearly that. But we need to see the background, why the words are chosen in order to address a specific problem happening in the church of Ephesus. So the church itself became very popular, and it had a great lucrative touristic attraction because of the temple of Diana or Artemis. And all those informations are not just in the book of Revelation, but when you read Acts chapter 18, 19, and 20, you would understand a lot of things happening in the city of Ephesus, but also in the church of Ephesus. And the town itself, or the church itself, was created or was established by Paul during his second missionary journey. He stayed there for a very short time, but before he left in the city of Ephesus, Aquila and Priscilla. And later, they had the help of Apollos, who also was a very hard worker to establish the church in Ephesus. And it's interesting because apparently the city became a center to evangelize the whole region. And in Acts 19, verse 10, it is said that, "And they which dwell in Asia heard the word of the Lord Jesus, both Jews and Greeks." So because of the testimony of what was happening in the church of Ephesus, the gospel was spread out into that whole region of Asia Minor. So you can understand why also the first church to be addressed is the church of Ephesus, because it became the mother church, the sending church to plant many other churches. And it's also interesting for us to know that the church of Ephesus hosted the most eminent preachers. Paul was there, Timothy was one of the pastors, the apostle John was also there, John Mark was there, plus Apollos and Aquila. They were all preachers in the church of Ephesus. So we can understand that this is really a church which has received so many privileges. And just one or two last aspect before we enter into the study as such. It's interesting because Paul never spent so much time. There is no other church or no other city where Paul spent so much time, except in the city of Ephesus, where he spent more than 2 years. And there, he also planted, if I may call it, the seminary, the Tyrannus Seminary in Acts 19. This is found there. And from that seminary, so many were trained, and church planters were sent from that seminary and from the church also. So it's really important to have those things in the background when we study the first church to whom the Lord Jesus Christ is writing in the book of Revelation. And to that church, in speaking with the elders in Acts 20, Paul said to the elders, "I have declared unto you the whole counsel of God." So you can imagine this church was indeed privileged. They had it all. Nothing was missing. They were given all the word of God. But it's good also to bear in mind that in all the seven churches, there is a standard structure, an outline. Each church begins with an instruction, then follows a description. And after the description, you have a commendation. After the commendation, you have a condemnation. After the condemnation, you have now an exhortation. After that exhortation, you have a solution. And after the solution, you have an invitation. So seven churches we can study in seven simple points. So we'll be following the way the Lord himself has addressed the churches, first of all, looking at the instruction. So the instruction is given in verse 1. "Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write. So that's a very standard structure. Each church write unto the angel of the church. So the question we should ask, who is that angel? Who is the angel? Well, the text doesn't tell us. We do not know. But we need to go back a bit behind, backward, in chapter 1. Chapter 1, verse 16 and verse 20. That will give us a clue about who is the angel to whom the letter is addressed. In verse 16, chapter 1, and he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was of the sun shining in his strength. This is the Lord Jesus Christ. He has in his right hand seven stars. And verse 20, the mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. So that gives us a clue. We do not know who is the angel, but we are told who are the stars. And the stars now are the angels also. So there is that relation. So the seven stars, we can say, are the seven angels of the seven churches. But you will bear with me that in the Word of God, the word angel can mean an angelic or a heavenly messenger or a spirit. But the word angel can also refer to a human messenger or an ordinary person. We don't have time to go into the verses, but you go back to Matthew 11, Luke chapter 9, and so on. The word angel is used for a human messenger, an ordinary person. And we don't need even to complicate it so much. I have never heard, or I have never read in the Word of God, somebody writing to an angelic angel or a heavenly angel. Nobody writes a letter to an angel as such. Does he need it? No, the angels do not need a written letter in order to do their mission. They are swift. They are quick. The holy angels have free access to the living God. They receive his orders and they obey without needing to receive a letter from anyone. So to make it sure, who is the angel? The angel here refers to the pastor, the leader, the overseer, the elder of the church. So because the messenger, or that human messenger, the pastor, is the one who represents the church before God. He speaks on behalf of the church, and when the letter is received, he must read it aloud to the church. So he speaks on behalf of the church. And his spiritual state represents also the spiritual state of the church. When the head is well, the body is well. When the pastor is liberal, the church will go liberal. When the pastor is compromising, the church will also be compromising. That's why the first letter is addressed particularly to the pastor, because the pastor is supposed to be the representative of the church before the Lord. And if he is well, the church is well. If he is going wrong, the church is also going wrong. So the seven stars are the seven angels, or the seven pastors, and the seven golden candlesticks are the seven churches. Which means that churches are light bearers. Every church is a light bearer. So that helps us to understand the first part of that first verse. It was an instruction, and the angel about whom the Lord is speaking is not a heavenly angel or a spirit, but it is a man, it is a person, it is the pastor, the elder, and the overseer of the church. So second, the Lord also gives us a description of himself. So we have a description of the Lord himself. How does the Lord describe himself in verse 1? Revelation chapter 2, verse 1. These things say, he that holdeth the seven stars, so we know the seven stars are the seven pastors, in his right hand who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks, and the seven golden sticks again are the churches. Oh, that reminds me, in the Garden of Eden, in Genesis chapter 3, God was walking in the garden. And here we have the Lord Jesus Christ walking in the midst of his church. Who is Eden? Oh, the same God of the Old Testament is the same Lord, the Lord Jesus Christ of the New Testament. In the same way that God walked in the Garden of Eden, the same way now we see the Lord Jesus Christ walking in the midst of his churches. And we have to explain a bit, why does the Lord presents himself or introduce himself or describes himself in this way? By the way, it's important to add to that. The way the Lord is described also explains to us what is wrong with the church. Each time when he presents himself and describes himself, it gives us a clue about the problem which is happening in the church. But in due time, it will come up because it's very relevant to mention that now. And the Lord, the text says, the Lord holds his messengers in his right hand. And the right hand, we all know that it's the hand, it symbolizes power and authority. So the Lord holds his messengers, his pastors, in his right hand of power. And he walks in the midst of his churches. And in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 22-23, it is said that God has put all things under his feet, under the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ, and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, in which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. Ephesians 1, verse 22-23. So the Lord Jesus Christ chooses his church, he chooses his servants, he builds his church, he said in Matthew 16, verse 18, and no one shall destroy his church. Even the devil cannot go against the holy church of the Lord Jesus Christ. So also the churches, but also the messengers, are accountable and they are responsible directly before him. So he appoints them, and in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, we are told that pastors and teachers are God's gift for his church. So he said, the text says, that these things say that he holdeth. Oh, that word is very important in the Greek text. It's not just holding something in my hand, but the meaning is that he is holding with great care. The Lord Jesus Christ is holding his messengers, he's holding his church in his hand with great care. And the meaning again is because it's precious and it needs protection. So the Lord keeps his church with care because his church is so precious. And you remember the description given to us about the candlestick? They are golden. They are golden candlesticks, the seven golden candlesticks, which means the church is precious. I don't know how much the church is precious to you, but for the Lord Jesus Christ, his church is precious. I would say it's even more precious than gold and silver, because 1 Peter chapter 1 tells us that we have been redeemed by the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, not by gold, nor by silver. So the church is precious before the Lord Jesus Christ, and his messengers are also precious. So we spoke about the instruction, the letter is addressed to the pastor, and the second step gives us a description about the Lord Jesus Christ, about his authority and his awareness. The Lord Jesus Christ is aware. He perceives everything happening in the church. The third point, it's a commendation. A commendation. If you want a praise, the Lord Jesus Christ gives a praise to his church. And the praise is said to us in verse 2 and verse 3. And it's interesting also to note that there is a praise for every church except the church of Laodicea. Hopefully you are looking forward to hear why there is no such praise to the church of Laodicea. Except that church, all the seven churches are praised and commended for something wonderful. But look carefully at the text. Verse 2. I know thy works. And again, the word to know there, it's not just an intellectual knowledge, or I see something and I know about it. The word means to know thoroughly, to know completely, to know from one end to the other end. Nothing is hidden to the Lord Jesus Christ. And when he says, I know thy works, it means also he knows everything happening in every church. He knows everything happening in the life of every person, every single person. Either you are a believer or a non-believer, the Lord knows everything about your heart, about your mind, about your will, about your thoughts, about your words. Nothing is hidden unto the living God. So that's very important. But what does he know about that church? And there is a whole list of several things mentioned in the list we are given. So the Lord gives or attributes many virtues to the church. And we can see, oh, if I can list four or five of them, just following the text here. First of all, the Lord says, they served him with great, great labor. They were involved in great labor, working very hard to serve the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's something very important for the church of Ephesus. So they labored hard, they toiled with sores, with intensity, but also they worked hard in patience. With patience, they worked very hard to serve the Lord. The second thing which is mentioned in the text also, they separated themselves from sin and from the world. Not only they served the Lord with great power, with great intensity, but they separated themselves from sin and from the world. And the third thing you can see in verse 2 and 3 is that they suffered great persecution. And believe me, the churches that time were not, didn't take things at ease. The persecution was at the door day and night, day after day. And we can believe, or we can guess probably, that most believers have suffered also a great loss. All their belongings certainly were taken by their persecutors. But there is another thing which is said about them, that they hated liars and false teachers. And they stood for great doctrinally, for sound doctrine, but they also stood against liars, and they have tested them that are saying they are apostles, but they were found false apostles who assumed just false titles. So the church was able to have great discernment. It was a working church, an enduring church, a discerning church, a vigilant church, a persevering. Oh, you think about any good aspect you can think about. That church was really involved in order to please the Lord. Because all what they did, the text tells us, all what they did it for the sake of the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So they worked very hard to show that indeed they stand with the Lord and they stand for the Lord. But among the people, the false teachers against whom they stood, in verse 6, one group is mentioned there, the Nicolaitans. But verse 6, but this thou hast hasted the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. So now, this group is a, we really don't know much about who they are. Some people believe it's a group which generated from Nicholas, from the book of Acts chapter 6. You remember in Acts chapter 6, When there was a problem in the church, seven men were chosen in order to help the apostles, while the apostles will give themselves to prayer and preaching. Seven men were chosen in order to serve at the tables. So one of them is Nicholas, and the Nicolaitans were successors or people who got their name from him. This is just one option. But the second option, we know from the next church, Pergamos, because they are again mentioned in the church of Pergamos, the Nicolaitans were false teachers involved with idolatry, involved with immorality, with debauchery and worldliness. So they wanted to bring the world, they wanted to bring immorality, they wanted to bring debauchery in the church. So that's why the church in Ephesus stood against them. But the third probability, which I believe personally there was, so first, from Nicholas, second, there are false teachers bringing false immorality and idolatry and debauchery in the church. But the third aspect, which can glue to them, which we will recognize them, is in their name. You know, the word democracy, it means what? The rule of the people. And I'm making a neologism here. The word Nicolaisi doesn't exist. The word doesn't exist. But making that rhyme with democracy and Nicolaisi, while democracy means rule of the people, Nicolaisi means the rule over people. Like Diotrephes in 3 John verse 9, those people who wanted to be the first, they wanted to be seen in the church. They are doing things in the church just to make a show of themselves so that everyone sees who they are. And they are shepherding over the people of God. So, to make it simple and short, the Nicolaitans were people who were ruling or trying to integrate and rule the church by hierarchy, while the church of the living God should be ruled by scriptures and by the power of the Holy Spirit. So the church of Ephesus stood against the Nicolaitans because they were trying to enter in the church. Oh, we are the best, we are the great, we are the first. But the word of God tells us, as it is said in verse 6, God hates them. And the church in Ephesus, the true believers of the church of Ephesus, hated them also. Oh, they had the fortitude of standing against religious charlatans. This is to the credit of the believers of the church of Ephesus. And we can give them credit for that. They hated what the Lord hated for his name's sake. So we can see, brothers and sisters, the Lord is not indifferent for a church who is doctrinally sound. When a church is doctrinally sound, the Lord is not indifferent to it. The Lord loves such church. Or we may say, when we read such good words said about the church of Ephesus, we may say, oh, what a great church. Good for them. Good for them. Many churches today do not stand such criteria to be an enduring church, to be a serving church, to be an orderly church, to be a disciplined church, to be a persevering church. Many churches nowadays cannot stand near the church of Ephesus at all. But look, there is a problem. In verse 4, nevertheless, that says it all. Here is the shock. There is a great shock. There is a problem. Something went wrong in the church of Ephesus. And here, the Lord is telling the church, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. I have something against thee. I don't know about you, but this scares me. It frightens me. For the Lord to have something against anyone. We remember in Hebrews, we are told that our God is a burning fire. So for the Lord to have something against a person, that must be a terrible situation, a terrible state to be in. But what is the problem? What is the crack in the church? What is that main problem which happened in the church of Ephesus? So verse 4 tells us, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. This speaks volume. Thou hast left your first love. What does it mean, that first love? Most preachers will go, oh, they lost their first love to the Lord Jesus Christ. That's of course true, but we have to dig more and find why it was so important that the Lord has to put it before them. And what I will do here, if you forgive me for this, is to turn to one or two other verses just to show you what finally was the main problem of this church. And I'm sure, without turning to the first verse, it's in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 13. This is a classic verse, which you don't need even to open your Bible. You should know that verse. Three things remains: faith, love, and hope. So now, we have the first verse, 1 Corinthians 13, verse 13. But please turn with me to 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 3. And we will compare. If you keep your hand in Revelation 2, verse 2, there is something we want to do just to get the real meaning or a clear idea about that first law which they have left. So 1 Corinthians, chapter 1 Thessalonians, I beg your pardon, 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 3. And we compare that with Revelation 2:2. And you will see there is something missing. The words are given to us in the same order, but there is something missing. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 3. Remembering without ceasing your work of faith and labor of love and patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God and our Father. But something is missing when you read Revelation 2:2. In the same order, the Lord Jesus Christ said to them, I know thy works. What is missing in comparison to 1 Thessalonians 1, verse 3? Your work of faith is missing. And thy labor, and there you can see love is missing. And thy patience, the third one, hope is missing. So the first love they have really left behind themselves is faith, hope, and love. So all the three elements are missing. They worked hard, they labor hard, they had great patience. Remember, as Spurgeon said, through patience or perseverance, the snail reached the ark. So they had great patience or perseverance, but faith is missing, love is missing, and hope is missing. But that's not all, because the text says in verse 4, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast lost. No, they didn't lose their first love. They left it. There is a difference between losing something and leaving something, which means they left their first love. It was a willful decision. It was intentional. They did it by intention, and they of course regretted what they have done. You will agree with me, brothers and sisters, that things don't just happen over a night. To leave the love of spiritual matters, to leave the love for one another, to leave the love for the Lord Jesus Christ doesn't just happen in a twinkling of an eye. It's something coming in the life of a person gradually, progressively. And this is what is happening with the church in Ephesus. So they lost that the love for spiritual matters. And in our case, we live also that love for spiritual matters. We skip one prayer meeting, if ever we come to the prayer meeting. We skip one Bible study, another Bible study. Then we start another Sunday. So progressively, we are leaving our first love, which should really help us to cleave unto the Lord and to love Him with all our hearts. Church becomes, when we leave our love for the things of God, church becomes a routine. Church becomes a convenience. Not a commitment. It's not a commitment anymore, but it's just a convenience, a routine, something we do out of duty, not out of love. Oh, brothers and sisters, we can do so many things to people without loving people. But the worst is when we do things out of duty and not out of love to the Lord. That's the worst for a believer. The heart is not in it. What a tragedy. I must hurry on. Because the fifth one, there is an exhortation. And in verse 5 and 6, we can see that exhortation is given to us as a warning. As a warning. And believe me, churches have closed and have lost their impact because they no longer communicate the love of Christ to the community. Being a light is an act of love. The church testimony in the community is an act of love. The people, when we speak, when we witness to them, they may think we are invading their private life. They may think we are harming them. But brothers and sisters, to witness to non-believers is an act of love. And not to witness is the opposite. A light must shine in the community in order to give away that light. When a church stops proclaiming the word of God, which is the light through biblical means and through the power of the Holy Spirit, it stops to be a church. And it's interesting if this will shock you or not. By the end of the Middle Ages, the church of Ephesus did not exist anymore. Enduring church, deserving church, disciplined church, but it lost completely its usefulness and it had dwindled, died completely. It is said in the Middle Ages there was a traveler who went to Ephesus. Can you imagine in that great city? There were only three believers, and I wouldn't even call them believers, because the traveler was so surprised when he met with the three so-called Christians. They were so ignorant about the word of God that they did not know even who is Paul or John. Well, you may say, this is them, it won't happen to us. But believe me, if we don't learn from history, history repeats itself. So that church became lethargic. The church became apathetic. And what happened today? Only a shadow of their former greatness remains. Only a shadow, ruins. Nothing else. No believers. Even some of the seven churches that we are studying, some have changed their names. Some are not anymore even called with the names we have in the Word of God. Why? Because they lost that first love. Oh, but we shouldn't stop there. The sixth one is the solution. And here, as you know, I always struggle with time. And the solution is given by the Lord Jesus Christ in order to regain back our first love. And He gives. Brothers and sisters, this is to the church, but we can apply it also to individuals. Have you lost your first love? Have you lost that hope? that faith, that hope, the Lord is giving four imperatives in this text, and they are so important. The first one, he says, remember. Remember, in verse 5, remember therefore whence thou art fallen. And actually, the word remember should be translated, keep on remembering. Keep on remembering where you have fallen from. If you don't know where you are going, this is an African proverb, if you don't know where you are going, at least you remember where you came from. That will help a lot. So remember, as soon as the Christian starts to forget, he is in a great danger. Remember the time you were converted. Remember how you got converted. Remember how you got saved. Remember the text. Remember the verse, remember the sermon, remember the Lord Jesus Christ, remember the sweetness of that fellowship, that initial fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember that time when you so zealous, so devouring zeal that you wanted to convert. In my case, I thought I would convert the whole world with that joy in me and that flame. Remember. Remember that day when you knee down before the Lord Jesus Christ, convicted by your own sins, convicted by the love of the Lord Jesus Christ, convicted that indeed He is God, He is the only Savior, He is the only mediator between God and man. Remember. Remember. So that's that's the divine prescription. You go to a doctor, he gives you a prescription. When we have left our first love, that love, that sweet love of the Lord Jesus Christ, remember. And the second, he says, repent. Repentance is always hard, but it is crucial. There is no salvation without repentance. And brothers and sisters, the repentance here is not to non-believers. We think sometimes repentance is only to non-believers. No, the Lord is talking to believers. There was a fault, it means there is a sin. And if there is a sin, there is something we must repent of. And as I have explained many times, repentance is to do with our mind. There must be a change of mind. There must be a change of heart. There must be a change of will. There must be a change of conduct. There must be a change of direction also. We are going this way. We have left the Lord, but now we want to come back to the Lord. And as you have seen, I raise my voice because the time is over. And the third one is we must return. We must return and repeat the things we used to do before for the Lord. And the fourth one is revive or be removed. Because twice in verse 5, the Lord Jesus Christ is repeating the same word. The repentance is so crucial. In verse 5, remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly. Oh, he may come, revive before he comes. It may be sooner than you may have thought. Or I will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. Twice the word repent is mentioned there. So remove, or revive, or be removed. That's the condition. So remember, repent, repeat the things you used to do before, and revive yourself, shake up yourself, wake up, says the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, I must come to conclusion. There is an invitation, and the invitation is given to us in verse 7. Verse 7 is a classic. In the book of Revelation, that expression, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit said unto the churches. This expression is mentioned 8 times in the book of Revelation. So which means it's a very important expression. And to each church, the Lord is reminded, he who hath an ear. We all have not just one, but two. So we can hear. We can hear. We can hear what he says. But it's interesting, not only the Lord is speaking, but here we have the Holy Spirit speaking, the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Holy Trinity, The Lord Jesus Christ is speaking to us. The Holy Spirit is also speaking to us. And the second thing is the invitation: to him that overcometh will I give to eat the tree of life. Who are the overcomers? It's the word Nike there, you know, the word Nike. The overcomers, the winners. Who are the winners about whom the Lord is talking here? And it will help us. 1 John chapter 5, verse 5 says, who is that overcometh the world but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? Who is the overcomer? The person who believes that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And finally, he says, I will give to eat the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. What is the tree of life? It goes back to Genesis chapter 2, Genesis chapter 3, Revelation 22. We have no time to explain more on that. But it's interesting, the tree of life symbolizes eternal life. And in John 17, verse 3, Jesus said, and this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. What is eternal life? Is to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. The dry tree on which Christ died on the cross of Calvary is here replaced by a living tree. No more curse. No more curse, only blessings. By his death, we have eternal life. The tree gives spiritual healing to the nations, and eternal life or heaven, paradise, the garden, is not a reward for faithfulness, but a free gift by God's grace. Here is my conclusion. Christ must be the center, the heart of the church. When a church fails to convey the true light of the Word of God, the Lord may remove its instrumentality. Please, the fact that the instrumentality will be removed has nothing to do with losing salvation. We are not talking here about losing salvation. A Christian, a true Christian, shall never lose his salvation. The light must always be bright and never run out of power. Why? Because the Lord Jesus Christ walks in the midst of his church to give power to his church. The church must be a light beacon to the community. And as Paul said, we are debtors. We are debtors to all men. The Lord has not left his love for us. We too must never leave our first love. Oh, may the Lord help us never to grow cold and always abounding in his love and work in looking forward to the day when we will be with him. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. May the Lord bless this study unto our hearts tonight. Let's close our time together by singing hymn 477. 477. Zeal is that pure and heavenly flame, the fire of love supplies. Hymn number 477.